Hi, I'm Gemma Dale from nabtrade, and I'm here to talk to you today about where we are in the market and where we are in the economic cycle. It's a bit of context, I think, for you and for all of us as investors, because it's such a challenging environment at the moment. When I've spoken to you before about the macro environment, I've had the privilege of being in a position to say rates are going higher. They're going higher for sure. You know, when we're coming off a low of 0.1%, it's an historic low, you know, not just centuries, but millennia. We've never seen rates at that level. When we say inflation is extraordinarily high and we expect it to fall, all of those factors, they're not predictable necessarily, but you could kind of see where we were in the cycle and how things were starting to change. It's a little bit different at the moment. We're in an environment where the data is not giving us very, very strong signals about what the future looks like. And that does make it a little bit more challenging for investors. But to some extent, it is useful to know where we've been and how things have changed and then what that might at least give you something to think about anyway as you position your portfolio in the future. So frankly, we keep coming back to the same two things. Inflation is still an issue in Australia. It is still an issue globally. And we're not talking about inflation anymore. You may have noticed we're not hearing about inflation all the time in the news, and it's not a headline in the newspaper. What we are seeing is a cost of living crisis. That's what you're hearing about, is this cost of living crisis. And the reason that we're using that terminology is not that inflation is still as high as it was, right? We know in Australia that inflation peaked close to 2 years ago, to be frank, very, very, very high levels, something we haven't seen for literally decades. And yet, as it has come back and it has fallen quite dramatically from a peak of, you know, 7-8% annually, back to, let's say, 3.5-4%, depends on which measure you use and whether you annualize or use quarterly. It has fallen a great deal, but prices are not falling. And it's really important to note that prices are still way above where they were. And the things that are most likely to be affecting you, particularly if you're a wage earner, are going to be things like rent. And unfortunately, those are some of the areas that have had the highest level of inflation. They're not coming back, right? So inflation is still much higher than the RBA would like it to be. Almost all central banks around the world are dealing with the same issues. There are a couple of standouts. The Bank of China, it's a bit of an issue that they have the opposite problem. Prices are falling, literally falling, and they have the issue of deflation. But in Australia, in the US, in the UK, in Canada and New Zealand, everywhere else, what we're finding is that inflation rocketed post-COVID and during that sort of late COVID period with supply chain issues and various other challenges. It has fallen from those peaks, but it hasn't fallen enough. So the RBA has a job to get inflation into that 2-3% band, and that job is not done. And the concern for all central banks is we now have this last mile, this challenge of getting inflation from much lower levels, but down into the band we're comfortable with, 2-3%. And that bit coming down from 4-3 and 3-2.5 is proving extremely difficult. Prices are pretty sticky. We also have the challenge that wages have picked up a little bit, and wages are always a challenge, right? Workers wish to be compensated, and to some extent demand to be compensated for their higher cost of living, which we're talking about all the time. But if you are an employer and you're paying higher wages, that's going to feed into prices. And so we get this concern about a 1970s style wage price spiral. We're not in that sort of situation, right? Like, neither wages nor inflation are really rocketing at that level, but it is a bit of a concern for the RBA. Now, the RBA, as absolutely everybody knows, has absolutely done their best to clamp down on inflation by increasing interest rates. We have a cash rate of 4.35% at the moment, and many, many people were talking about rates starting to fall during this year, this calendar year, even this financial year, which is sort of coming to a close at this point in time, that rates would start to fall. And their reasoning for that was that the economy was going to roll over, that the incredible uplift we've seen in rates from 0.1% to 4.35% was going to massively squeeze the consumer. It was going to put businesses under an enormous amount of pressure. And so we were going to start to see a real deterioration in economic activity. And when we saw an uptick in unemployment and a decline in economic activity, inflation would start to fall and the RBA would be able to cut rates. That was a global theory and a global story. And we know that that has not really played out. The reason it hasn't really played out is the economic data is still okay. It's not fantastic. We know it's not fantastic, right? So economic growth is certainly not very, very strong at the moment. This is not the rocketing rebound out of COVID that we did experience briefly. This is quite a different situation. So economic growth is positive. We are not currently in a recession. There are a lot of Australians who feel like we're in a recession, and it does feel for certain parts of the market, certain businesses, and for a lot of consumers that there's a lot of stress in the economy, but that is not translating into a recession, which is technically two quarters of negative economic growth. We have not seen that. Now, if you are feeling squeezed, part of the challenge is we are actually in a per capita recession. So we've had enormous, enormous growth in the population, primarily as a result of immigration. A lot of that was catch up from COVID, but we're past the catch up stage now. Huge numbers of people are joining the economy, and those people are driving demand for any number of things, right? When you come to the country, you're going to need somewhere to live, you're going to need a car, you're going to need various items. You have found a job, broadly speaking. The employment data is telling us that most people are finding a job if they want one. And so we have an uplift overall in economic activity, but when you divide it by the total number of people in the economy per capita, we're going backwards. So that's why you feel pretty stressed financially and you feel like things are going backwards. At a personal level, they might be, but at an overall level, because that's what we measure, aggregate economic activity, the economy is still going forward. So we have this really tricky scenario from an economic perspective. There is positive growth. It's not fabulous growth, but it is positive. We have relatively full employment, right? Employment's looking really, really strong. Most people who want a job have one. When I was at university, the idea that you could have unemployment below 4% for as long as we have was sort of, it was inconceivable, but we do. We have really, really strong employment. And we do have this fairly sticky inflation problem. It's not super high, but it's definitely higher than the RBA would like it. So when you look at that picture, you can see now that rates expectations have changed a lot from we're going to have to cut to we will cut when things start to fall apart, right? So we're not going to start cutting yet. There's not enough reason, right? The data is not telling us we need to do that. So what does that mean about how you invest? The reason we talk about inflation and rates so much is they absolutely do affect where you choose to invest and where you choose to put your money. If you happen to be a deposit holder and you have money to invest, and most of the people listening to this will be, then you have a whole range of choices available to you that you didn't have a while back, right? When rates were 0.1%, keeping your money in the bank, even when inflation was low, you were still going backwards. After inflation, after tax, if you're paying any. So now you're not going backwards anymore, right? The cash rate is marginally above inflation, depending on which measure you use, and depending on where you're holding your money. You've got cash sitting there and you can choose to invest it. So far, equities markets have been holding up remarkably well. We know about housing because it gets a ton of press, but when we look at equity markets, they've also been holding up really well. And when you're getting dividends from Australian companies, most of those have been paying you more than the cash rate plus the benefits of franking. So those who are holding equities have been doing really well. And if you've been holding US equities, you've been doing extraordinarily well. Although part of the challenge when you look at US equities is that it's been a really concentrated numbers of stocks that have been driving most of the performance there. There's been a massive hype around AI, which has been driving a lot of the hopium, as a lot of people try to call it, the enthusiasm for stocks in the US market. not the economy. We know that AI is not the economy. It's one tiny little part of the market, but it's been doing really, really well. And if you're an investor and you have exposure to those things, you're feeling really good. So Australian investors are generally feeling pretty good, but their biggest question is, where do I go from here? The advantage of coming to this event, if you're fortunate enough to come in person or to tuning into this kind of thing, is that you get to see lots of awesome ideas from lots of different professional investors, and they can help you make sense of what is a fairly complex environment. We don't really know where things are going to go, but they can talk to you about some of the more exciting opportunities that do exist, because as we know, very, very difficult to predict where markets are going to go, very difficult to predict where economies are going to go, and being invested is one of the best ways to manage some of those risks and challenges. So hopefully you can tune into some of those sessions, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.